Thank you, Dan. And since somehow I trusted Dan, I'm taking, I agree with his word about the confidence and the good spirit of this model, and I would like to ask all the modelists and the theoretician to treat my teasing and my, I would say, rumors of their role in understanding the brain and the basal ganglia is actually a kind of trying to give them motivation to move to the correct place of science, or the correct place of the brain, and this is the basal ganglia. And okay, but the basal ganglia, the basal ganglia are not working. And actually, what I would like to start is with the thanks. So actually, you see it is close circle between Elon, Ifat, Tzvi Israel, and me, but and many, many others that contribute for many, many years to this work. But the work that I'm going to describe today was done mainly at the beginning by Avital Adler and Mati Yoshua, and now Ina Finkes is joining Avital and doing the next step of this work, and all the mistakes belong to me and not to them. So I'm assuming that most of you are familiar with the basic fact of the basal ganglia. Clearly today with the basal ganglia is a part of a reinforcement learning machine. And to make a long story short, most of us believe that we can divide the basal ganglia into two divisions. One is the main axis, or the actor of the basal ganglia, where all cortical area from the frontal cortex up to the visual cortex project to the input stage of the basal ganglia, the striatum and the subthalamic nucleus. From there, information continue to the external segment of the globus pallidus, GPE, and from the GPE, the information continue to the output stage of the basal ganglia, the internal segment of the globus pallidus, the GPI, and the substantia nigra pars reticulata. And from there, information continue to the frontal cortex, where the information is going downstream in the corticospinal, corticobrainstem pathway to the muscle and to the action machinery. So this is the main axis where we usually say that state is coming over here and action is performed, and this is the loop. And the other part of the basal ganglia is again in machine learning or reinforcement learning theory. This is the critic, or in more classical biological sense, it will be the neuromodulator part of the basal ganglia. And this is the substantia nigra pars compacta located in the midbrain, send axon to the input stage of the basal ganglia to the striatum and provide the dopamine signal, the neuromodulation, or the TD error, or the critic signal. And it is not only the substantia nigra pars compacta, we have also the cholinergic modulation of the basal ganglia by the tonically active neuron of the striatum, acetylcholine, providing acetylcholine. We have 5-HT, and probably the list of the neuromodulator is quite long. To make a long story short, if we are thinking about the basal ganglia, we can say that the basal ganglia is built as a feed-forwarded network of projection neuron. So in the striatum, in the globus pallidus, in the substantia nigra pars reticulata, we have only one layer. It is projection neuron that receive most of the neuron in each one of these nucleus are, in each one of these nuclei are input and output together. So it is only one layer. There are no hidden layer. We can ignore the few interneurons that are located over there, or we can identify them. And so it is feed-forward information because there are no back projection from the striatum to the cortex, and from the thalamus, which is connected to the frontal cortex, back to the basal ganglia. Inside the basal ganglia, we have some loop, but input and output to the basal ganglia is feed-forward. And again, unlike the problem that we are seeing, if we are speaking about the cortex and we have no idea which kind of cell we record in extracellular recording in behaving animal, over here, when we record in the GPE, GPI, we know that all the cells are the projection neuron, and therefore it is very homogeneous activity. Second issue is the issue of anatomical funneling. And if we consider the number of neurons, let's say, in the monkey, we usually believe that about 10 to the 9 neurons in the cortex project to the input stage of the basal ganglia, the striatum. In the striatum, we have 10 to the 7 neurons, and then the next step in the output stage of the basal ganglia in the internal segment of internal segment of the globus pallidus, we have 10 to the 5. So it is about one or two order magnitude of reduction in the number of neurons from the input to the output stage of the basal ganglia. This is what you refer by anatomical funneling. Third, a unique characteristic of the basal ganglia is shown over here. You see that there are white arrow for glutamate and yellow for GABAergic transmission. And again, unlike the cortex, in the basal ganglia, GABA, which is inhibitory transmitter in the basal ganglia, is used to carry information. And of course, it is not only used to carry information, it is also used for lateral interaction, and this is something which is characterized the basal ganglia. Finally, there is a diversity of discharge range in the striatum. Most neurons discharge at, let's say, 0.5 to 1 hertz, and in the GPE, GPI, SNR, then neuron fire at a very high frequency discharge rate, something like 50 to 70. And we all know that the basal ganglia are related to plasticity, reinforcement learning on one side, and then when we lose our dopaminergic neuron, it is related to Parkinson's disease. So clearly it's something that we care about it, okay? We care about the basal ganglia, and maybe we can understand better what the basal ganglia do by looking at this important structure of the brain. So the first question that we'd like to ask is, what is encoded by the basal ganglia? And the classical approach to this question, what is encoded by the visual cortex, by the motor cortex, is to train monkey for a behavioral task. For example, in our case, we train monkey to a classical conditioning task with 7 cues, 3 cues, the cues are given for 2 seconds, 3 cues predict the future food, the future reward. With this cue predict the food is probability of 1, this is probability of 2/3, and this is probability of 1/3. 3 cues predict a future air puff, that is it. And then at the end of the cue, the monkey will get air puff to the eye. And again, with the probability of 1/3, 2/3, and 1. And 1 was the neutral cue. And of course, there is the outcome. And what people are usually do is to insert electrode into different structure to record the activity of neuron, have the raster display, the peristimulus histogram. And in this case, to say that this neuron is more reactive to the aversive, red is usually the aversive cue, than to the reward predicting cue. But what we have decided is not to do what most people do usually, but to be very, very careful, and I'd like to come to this point, first about the quality of recording that we are doing, and second, to record for the same task in different structure. So let's start about the isolation quality. What I think it is really important that it's still missing in the literature, that people that are doing extracellular recording don't tell you objective criteria for the quality of the recording. Most of them will say, we have very well isolated unit, okay? And you have to trust them, okay? And of course, if you ask their neighbor, they will tell you that I have very well isolated neurons, their neurons are multi-unit, okay? And it will be vice versa, okay? And therefore, I think it is critical, again, having today literature, to have some quantification of the isolation criteria, okay? And each one of us can select whatever isolation criteria you'd like. We develop one, it is in Journal of Neuroscience Method, but there could be, my point is that quantitative data should start with number, okay? it is not good enough that we do very sophisticated information analysis and give number in bits later if we don't know what is the isolation quality, what is the base of our data. And in our cases, okay, what we've done is that we decided that our isolation quality is greater than, it is from 0 to 1, is greater from 0.8. We recorded also the dopaminergic neuron. Our ability to discriminate between neuron of the substantia nigra compacta is less than we are able in other place. And over there, our isolation quality is only, the inclusion criteria was isolation quality bigger than 0.5. So I think it is important to put it on the table. For example, you know that you should trust my result less for the dopaminergic neuron than for other neural structures that I have in mind. The other inclusion criteria was recording time greater than 30 minutes, and altogether, the database that I'm going to speak about it is data that was recorded by Avital and Mati from two monkeys. Altogether, almost 900 neurons cross the inclusion criteria, you see, and we recorded the neuron of the neuromodulators, so the substantia nigra compacta, the dopaminergic neuron, and the cholinergic interneuron of the striatum. So these are the neuromodulation. We recorded this, and we recorded also neuron of the GPE, GPI, SNR, and you have the number. You see over here the mean isolation score, so the inclusion criteria was greater than 0.8, but you see the mean isolation score, usually around 0.9, okay? The mean fraction of ISI that are shorter than 2 milliseconds, that is that we have a spike within the refractory period, and again, this is less than 2 promile, and the mean recording time, which was almost 1 hour or 300 trials, okay? So if seven cues, 300 trials, and this is the mean, and this is the database. And then we started with the classical approach, and the classical approach was to calculate the population PSTH. So you see over here the population PSTH for the TANS, the cholinergic interneuron, for the substantia nigra compacta, for the SNR, GPE, GPI. In blue, it is the reward-related event. Okay, so this is in blue. Over here, blue is the response to the cue. In red is the response to the ERPAF. Okay, and I'm careful not to say aversive ERPAF event. And in green is the response to the neutral. And these are the response to the cue, to the outcome, to the omission of the outcome. Again, for these two population, everything is in the literature. I only would like to point to one major issue is that look at the response of dopaminergic neuron to reward-related event. There is a spritz of dopamine. Okay, we all know. But also for the ERPAF, okay? For the ERPAF that is given to the eyes, and we can discuss if ERPAF is aversive or ignored by the monkey, but clearly this is not rewarding event, okay? ERPAF to the eye. And also for the ERPAF, we see that the dopaminergic neuron respond with increase in firing rate. And when we omit the reward, because it was probability, okay, so they have the probability 1/3 and 2/3. When we omit either the food or the ERPAF, we see the same response of the dopaminergic neuron. So dopaminergic neuron don't, it is very, very clear that dopaminergic neuron don't encode exactly the pleasure TD error, okay? It's something more complicated, okay? It is not pure the pleasure TD error, it is something more complicated. And again, we have a plenty of response over here, and it is very, very difficult to understand. And actually, what I would like to claim, that the major problem is that when we are studying the response of the basal ganglia or every place in the brain, the response to behavioral event, we are like the blind people looking at the animal. One is seeing if we test for reward, we'll see reward. If we test for TD error, we see TD error. Movement parameter, movement stop, and so on and so on. And the bottom line is that, in my opinion, that the basal ganglia, but most of the brain of monkeys that are required to perform a behavioral task that provides their food. Without this food, they will not survive. Okay? So the food is the most important, the behavioral tasks that the monkey are engaged are the most important thing in their life, okay? So it is not the big surprise that the response to this behavioral task will reflect the parameter of the task, whatever they might be. So we are having a problem. In the moment that we are out of probably the retina and the other primary sensory organ, in the moment that you are coming to the central nervous system, the task will affect our results. No. But they eat the food, okay? And we have to, there is no way to have... anyway, so what we can still learn... Yeah. Pardon? They act, of course they act. If you give food, they have to lick it, okay? If you give air puff, they have to blink. They act, okay? They are engaging behavior. Of course, for example, they get the cues that predict air puff, okay? So they have to blink before the air puff is coming, okay? And so on. So it's part of action. Again, of course, we believe that doing this and being this or driving a car is a more complicated behavioral task. But I would say, I don't know. Again, the point is that they have to perform action, even in classical conditioning, they have to be, they are engaged in action, okay?
But the blinking has nothing to do with their food, you know, so the brain is more than just what I get to eat with.
Again, this monkey don't get only air puffs, they get also food in the, and therefore actually we started with the assumption that food is a rewarding event and air puff is aversive, and we did opposite, it will be symmetric and be able to say something about good and bad prediction. Today, I believe that, again, we cannot compare it, okay? Because our air puff is never, we can never give a monkey an aversive stimuli that will be as aversive as the pleasure that is getting from the food that is depending on it, okay? So it is always a big question about if we, using our ethical rule, of course, I can bleed the monkey or do something which is unethical. But within my ethical rule, there is a big question about the symmetry of air puff versus reward. So I'm leaving it apart. What I'm trying to say is that every task that will train a monkey, you will see responses in the basal ganglia. You will train a monkey to move a stick with his hand, the basal ganglia will move to the movement of the hand. You will train a monkey to move a stick with leg, the basal ganglia will respond to the leg movement. Because this is the issue of a plastic system. So the bottom line that still I think that we can learn is to look at the temporal profile of the response of the neuromodulator, the substantia nigra pars compacta and the tonically active neuron, and of the main axis, okay? So this is 2 seconds of the cue, and you may see that the average responses of the neuromodulator or the critic are very, very short, where the responses of the neuron in the main axis are very long, okay? So this is one issue that I think that we should keep in mind regarding what we are trying to say, who is the critic, who is the actor. This is clearly in line with the critic properties, and we are very happy. But then we decided, actually, that we should... Yeah.
On the previous slide, is the population average of the main axis, does that reflect the average of lots of tonic neurons, or does that also reflect the average neuron? And this trend, this persistent
effect? It is the average response of all neurons.
Right. But does it reflect lots of spikes that are moved, or do most neurons look like that?
Most neurons do like that, okay? So most neurons, again, so we have the fraction of neurons. Again, it is in the paper, so we have the fraction of neurons that respond. And indeed, most of the neurons, so almost all neurons in the basal ganglia respond to the task, okay? Huge majority of them. So we decided, like, again, it is very, very clear cut to say, okay, let's not only record the responses of single neuron, let's look at the network. And the way that we experimentalists look at the network is that we are not putting single electrode, we put several electrodes, In our case, it's between 4 to 8 microelectrode. In this case, it's into the external segment of the globus pallidus. This is 1 second, but we've done it in all places. And again, the criteria were the same. That is, the isolation quality was bigger than this. The recording time was the simultaneous recording time was greater than 30 minutes. And we took for the cross correlation, we took only pairs from different electrodes. So to avoid problem with spike sorting and shadowing and other issue, at this stage we only look at pairs recorded from different electrodes. And again, the database is given in over here. We have number of pairs in each of the structure. Okay, so we have pairs of cholinergic interneuron with cholinergic interneuron, dopaminergic with dopaminergic, GPE with GPE, GPI with GPI, SNR with SNR. Okay? And then the question that we'd like to ask ourselves is, do the response, let's start with the question, do the response of this neuron similar? So whenever two neurons recorded simultaneously responded to the same event, okay, we calculate the correlation of the response. Okay, so let's say in the GPE we have 6,000 responses. In only in 1,400 of them we have the two neurons respond simultaneously to this event. And when we calculated the correlation of these responses and we plot the distribution of this correlation, we see that it is, this is, so this is the correlation coefficient, 1 very correlated, 0 not correlated, -1 oppositely correlated, and this is the fraction. We see that in the main axis, the correlation of the responses are symmetrically distributed around the 0, where No. It is PSTH to PSTH.
But what varies? There is a different.
For each pair, okay, I have 18 events. Agree? I have the 9 Qs and I have the outcome. So for each pair, I have 18 events. I'm taking the response to each one of the events. If the two neurons respond to the same event, I'm calculating the correlation between the two PSTH. Yeah, just the shape of the PSTH. Okay? This is response correlation, okay? And provided the two neurons respond. Therefore I'm having over here it is. This is the total number of responses, and this is the cases where the two neurons responded. Okay, that it was significant. Okay, and again, what you see is again the main story is compare this let's say symmetric distribution of response correlation in the main axis to the right shift of this distribution of correlation of response correlation between done pairs and tonically active pairs. Okay, it is strongly shifted to the right, and you have the number over here. Okay, this is the average. This is the correlation between single response. Of course, what we can do is to correlate the signal correlation. Okay, so to look for the signal correlation or the similarity of the tuning curve. Okay, so now what we compare is not the responses to a single event. We have two neurons. We have the vector of responses of the two neurons to the whole event, and we compare what we correlate is the vector of responses of the two neurons. So this is the classical signal correlation. Okay, so what we do is that we cut the time axis to 100 millisecond bin, and for each one of the pair, we calculate it in all this 100 millisecond bin, and then sum it and sum it again. Okay?
So you do have separate time bins also. So this is like the PSTH. Except that you have bin in 100 milliseconds.
PSTH is all the time binned, okay, by definition, okay? You can bin it in 1 millisecond, and you can bin it...
So the difference is the binning.
Pardon?
So this is the difference between signal correlation...
No. The difference between signal correlation and response correlation is that I'm taking only one response at the time, okay? I care my elementary unit in the response correlation is response to one behavioral event. Over here, the elementary event is the neuron. So I take all the responses of this neuron, okay? So, again, just to make it clear. Let's say that I have this response to the cue, this response to the outcome, and this response to, and so on, so on, okay? And this is one neuron, and neuron number two is this one. Okay? For signal correlation, I'm comparing all this vector to this vector. This is the
component by component.
Component by component.
So this is like averaging these cages.
Whatever. Okay? But this is this is the
In response correlation,
I take this and correlate, and then I take this and correlate, and take it could be. It could be. I'm not arguing too much about it. I don't know. I agree. Actually, we'll come to the bottom line that I'm saying that they are very, very similar. Okay, so this is not a... so. Okay. Exactly. Okay. So again, but this is the classical signal correlation. Okay. And again, I think that this is what we are used to see in signal. This is very similar to the results that we used to see in signal correlation in the cortex. Okay. But this shift to the right is very unique to the basal ganglia, and again to the basal ganglia critic. And finally, of course, we can calculate also the noise correlation. That is, what is the we have the average response, and we look at the fluctuation of the response above the average responses. And again, we see that the noise correlation is about symmetric for the main axis and shifted to the right for the critic. We can look for stimulus-induced synchronization by calculating of the joint PSTH, and we got very interesting difference that for the dance we see modulation, but not for the dance. But I'm, at this time I don't carry. I have to follow Idan idea, and this is for Chaim. This is for Chaim that actually what I'm saying that all the basal ganglia correlation measures are correlated. So I gave you the response. Okay, but we are going to take it one step more. Okay, so we have the response correlation, the signal correlation, and the noise correlation, and this is the response to signal correlation and the signal to noise correlation, and you see that in most cases they are strongly correlated. The point that I would like to take is that actually when we are coming back to the most classical analysis that we used to do, spike to spike cross correlation. Okay, so this is the back to the time that Elon and me started in 76, okay, 1976, we've done spike-to-spike cross-correlation, okay? And again, if we are looking now, this is the spike-to-spike cross-correlation of tonically active neurons, so this is the matrix of cross-correlation of the tonically active neuron. You see very, very nice symmetric peak, okay, in the middle, and this is, ignore the blue. The blue are the autocorrelation. In the red are the spike-to-spike cross-correlation in the globus pallidus that are completely flat, okay? So actually what I'm trying to offer that it could be, okay, that the spike-to-spike cross-correlation reflect the basal ganglia response to the bombarding of the nervous system by external and internal event, okay? So usually it is very, very nice to us. We have signal correlation. We train our monkey to have a task with this and this event. But the monkey is sitting over there. There is incoming information from the outside, from the inside. And the response are some kind of, in the spike-to-spike correlation, what we suggest or what I suggest actually reflect the summation of the response of all this signal correlation. And therefore, I think that it is very nice to come back and now to look at all this event that we have done. It is spike-to-spike cross-correlation, response correlation, signal correlation, noise correlation. These are the correlation between the measure. And we have it for the dance, for the dance, for the GPE, GPI, and SNR. And again, the bottom line is that taking all this device all this measure, it is very, very clear that we can divide our basal ganglia into structures that are highly correlated versus structures that are much less correlated. And from our point of view, this is in line with the actor-critic model of the basal ganglia, that what we'd like that the critic would give a single message to the student, okay? So if the actor is the student class, we don't like teacher to give ambiguous information. We'd like all the teacher to give the same message to the class, and or at least all the dopaminergic teacher, for example. And therefore, in the normal monkey, what we found is that it is transient and locally correlated response of the basal ganglia modulator of the dance and the dance versus the sustained, diverse, and not correlated response of the basal ganglia main axis. Yes. Noise correlation. Let's keep the issue of noise correlation to the end, because again we have I just discussed it with Chaim, the paper of Logothetis and the problem with noise correlation. I've tried to show that we overcome most of the problems that Logothetis claim. Again, noise correlation is the most problematic measure of our correlation, because it is fluctuation above average firing rate. I think that signal correlation is much more solid, and from my point of view, the main difference that I see is between this two number and this three number. I think this is the main issue, and between this and this, okay? And therefore, we can discuss noise correlation, but so of course, if this is the basal ganglia, then the question is, what happens when we lose dopamine? Okay, so if dopamine is so important, does it affect the main axis? And again, to make a long story short, if these are the flat cross correlation in the main axis of normal monkey, when we lose dopamine and we do it by giving a monkey MPTP and creating a state of Parkinson's disease, a huge amount of synchronous oscillation develop between pairs of pallidal neuron and substantia nigra reticulata. So actually, I think it is time to come back and to come back to what David Marr told us. What is the meaning of understanding of a neural network? And David Marr actually spoke about, David Marr in his book Vision, spoke about three levels of understanding. The first level is the computational level, okay? What is the goal, what is the computational goal of the network? And clearly, again, this is well known, that especially if we are speaking about the critic, the basal ganglia network solves the problem of learning an optimal behavioral policy while interacting with a stochastic environment who is delayed and incomplete, so weakly supervised learning, okay? This is well known. What is in the algorithmic level, okay? Again, the algorithmic level is very, very clear. The substantia nigra pars compacta, the dopaminergic neuron, provide the temporal difference error or the mismatch between prediction and reality, and maybe not only pleasure, but of the complex space of pleasure and arousal, okay? I will leave it to some other place, and modify the basal ganglia actor state to action mapping. So modify the behavioral policy and of course update the value of the substantia nigra. And in the so we have the computational goal, the algorithmic level, and the implantation level is that we have homogeneous distribution of dopamine innervation in the striatum. And again, we show that indeed the dopamine signal is correlated, and the dopamine and activity dependent plasticity, for example, by triple Abelian rule, modify the corticostriatal synapse to enhance this connection that were active when the dopamine spritz happened. So this is nice, and this is in every textbook. But what it is completely ignored is the actor, okay? So everybody knows that the basal ganglia do temporal difference and reinforcement learning. But what is the computational algorithm and computational hardware employed by the main axis? How does the system do what it does? How do the basal ganglia encode the state to action mapping, okay? How do the what representation do the basal ganglia network use, and what process does the basal ganglia actor employ to build and manipulate this representation? And finally, how the system is realized, okay? What are the connections and what is the functional connectivity within the system? And what I would like to claim that we can, if we are going back to the model of the basal ganglia, we can really look at three different models of the basal ganglia, and we can select our best using our cross-correlation results. So the first model, again, that I should admit I'm a little bit responsible for it, is the rate model of the basal ganglia. This is the Kandelin-Schwarz model, that the basal ganglia, each box in the basal ganglia, each nucleus in the basal ganglia is one box that can increase or decrease its firing rate, okay? So, and when we deplete dopamine, there is increased activity in all internal segment globus pallidus, there is over-inhibition of the cortex, and therefore with Parkinson's akinesia. This is the classical model of the basal ganglia. But if each box is a single, each nucleus is a single box, then all the neurons in this box should be correlated, and we know that this is not the case, okay? So next generation was doing, we say, okay, so one nucleus of the basal ganglia is not one box, it's two box, okay? For example, action selection, okay? So again, you see the model of action selection or a kind of winner take all, okay? So again, it depends what is the source, but usually we'll speak about a focus of activation or inhibition, or a focus of disinhibition that is going in the middle of the basal ganglia, and then a surround inhibition. Okay, so actually we select one action, and then we inhibit all other action. Okay, so we divide now each basal ganglia nucleus to two box. But again, if this is the case, then the correlation inside the actor should be either highly positive if they are either in the center or both are outside of the center, or very negative if one of the neurons is in the black and one of the neurons is in the white. And finally, the last model is from one box to two box to many box, okay? This is what we try to believe, that the basal ganglia are doing a kind of dimensionality reduction of the cortical information. Okay? And the dimensional reduction means that there is not it is not that the basal ganglia encode action or select action. They do a reinforcement driven dimensional reduction of the cortex, and by this and by reinforcement I mean that when you are a kid you should try to develop a behavior for your grandmother. Okay? So when you are a kid, it is very, very important that your grandmother will be a class of itself, and whenever the grandmother is coming, you kiss her because you get the chocolate, okay? Suddenly, you are grown up and you kiss someone else, okay? So you need a reinforcement driven...
And you don't get chocolate.
Well, each one of us. And anyway... The point is that we need this dimensional reduction to be plastic, okay? Again, we don't care too much. Again, if it is a grandmother, it is a grandmother. But at some point in your time, all grandmother can be the same in one class. So this is the reinforcement-driven dimensional reduction of the basal ganglia. And of course, according to this, we accept no correlation between the neuron in the output structure of the basal ganglia as we got in our measure. So to summarize and to conclude, I think that the correlation between the signal response and the signal and response correlation and the spike-to-spike correlation measure in the basal ganglia suggests that the spontaneous spike-to-spike correlation represents the summation of the signal correlation induced by the continuous bombarding of the nervous system by external and internal event. And actually, therefore, I'm coming back to the classical idea and saying, you don't have to work too hard. It is enough that the monkey will behave, will do some kind of natural behavior, and you'll do spike-to-spike correlation, and you'll be able to understand a lot about the functional connectivity of the network. Second issue is that our results support the actor-critic model of the basal ganglia network, suggesting the basal ganglia network solves the problem of learning optimal behavioral policy by reinforcing driven dimensional reduction of the cortical information space. And we believe that this might be the reason for the basal ganglia to use GABA as a carrier of information. Because if keep in mind that we have only, it is one neuron, layer of one neuron. The neuron that is getting the information is the neuron that project and do the lateral connectivity. So I think it is much easier to decorrelate a network of inhibitory neuron than, or neurons that use inhibitory transmitter than to decorrelate a network of excitatory neuron. And finally, is that the synchronous basal ganglia oscillations that develop when we lose dopamine probably represent the hallmark of Parkinson's disease, and they are leading to the main symptom of Parkinson's disease, that is the akinesia. I was hoping that I still have 2 minutes. This is them. I was hoping that there will be students over here or people that are still looking for a job, okay? And because you're looking for a job? Okay. You're most welcome. So your to-do list, okay? So first of all, working hypothesis, okay? So our to-do list is affected by our working hypothesis that the understanding of the basal ganglia network is limited more due to the lack of high-quality experimental data. And this experimental data should be driven by today computational model and studied with today analysis tool, rather than by lack of computational model of tools. I think that what we really lack is good experimental data. And therefore, what we have to do is to do multiple neuron recording in the striatum, the main input stage of the basal ganglia of the monkey, engage in a very similar task. And then actually, I think that we should verify that there is a redundancy reduction along the striatum GPE-GPI axis. Because if we believe in our dimensional reduction model, there should be a redundancy reduction along the axis. And again, one should look for more aspect of this model to verify or to disverify and to look for a better model. Second thing to do is to do multiple neuron recording in different territory of the cortex. We are thinking about M1, the dorsolateral frontal cortex, the associative cortex, and the cingulate, the limbic cortex, and develop insights for the cortical data. And I think really that the cortical data is much more complicated because it is very heterogeneous neuronal organization, and moreover, read the basal ganglia, cortex is both in the input and the output side, okay? So whenever we record neuron, we don't know if it is projected to the basal ganglia or get information from the basal ganglia or both of them. And finally, this is, again, I did not have the time to speak about it, but again, this is something that we really care about. It is that I think it is important to test the hypothesis that the basal ganglia are not trying to maximize future discount cumulative reward, where punishment is considered as minus reward, okay? So today, most of us believe that the basal ganglia are trying to solve one axis optimization problem. That is, we have reward, punishment is minus reward. This is exactly for Tali, and therefore, what the basal ganglia are doing is that do multi-objective optimization process, for example, optimal trade-off between cost and benefits, okay? And
cost is not punishment?
No. But this is the point. If you are, again, this is related to Tali, again, this is the point that cost can be orthogonal to benefit, okay? And therefore, you have the problem of let's start with two-dimensional optimization, which is not one-dimensional optimization. So you have to maximize your cost, to minimize your cost while maximize your benefit, okay? And this is not exactly as one minus the other, okay? Okay, so, and this is just the promo, so if you will come next week to the IBAGS, to International Basal Ganglia Society meeting, you will be able to see the poster of Avital and the INA that recorded already in the striatum, and they have a lot of story about the cross-correlation in the striatum, but this is a new story for the next year.
Good test of what the model says about the axis. something is learned, what stage has been learned, what is modified. You know, we heard from Elon, you know, there is a task, and there is plasticity, and these are the changes, and we can interpret them. And here it's all about correlations, about critic. If there is a model, why not test the model? In the main axis, tell us what is the task, what are the changes during learning, etc. And how is it? I mean, is it selection? What are the different tasks? How do we see in the neurons recode or encode the new tasks, etc.?
I think that you are going into the classical trap, which I say that we should be aware that behavioral tasks affect the results that you'll get from the basal ganglia, okay? And actually what you are saying, and I think that this is the trap that everybody in the motor cortex already is inside, because when people test for forces, they say that the motor cortex is responding to force. When they test for a direction, then motor cortex is responding to direction. When they test for visual stimuli, they see the visual stimuli. You are going, this is exactly...
The alternative
is this, okay? Whenever...
So we understand how the basal ganglia works, and we can just go on to do something.
But now you... Well,
the
only thing is that you have to verify it, okay? For example, which kind of dimensional reduction is done? It's probably not PCA.
Reduction is not doing a task. It's something which is not super...
No. This is reinforcement-driven dimensional reduction, okay? Because, again, so first of all, it is not PCA. PCA... Okay, it is driven, but this is reinforcement driven. Okay, it should be. You should give the same. So first of all, it is reinforcement driven dimensional reduction. It is not PCA. Okay, because it does not make that it does not make sense to be PCA. So the question is, yeah, you can go ahead. So the question is, which kind of dimensional reduction? And as I said, I think that the main issue that we lack good experimental data. Okay, it is not. It is not that there is. Pardon?
What is good prediction about? Suppose I'm planning a high quality experimental data.
Okay.
What should I look for?
For example, I train a monkey for 1 year. Okay, you will come to the lab. You will train a monkey for 1 year. Okay, every day from 8 to 4 o'clock. Okay, and you will train a monkey to do the task by arm movement. Okay, the monkey will learn the task and you will record the basal ganglia. Okay, then. You will wait, okay? Retrain the same monkey to do the same task with his tail, okay? With his tail, okay? Now we'll move the cursor, okay? With his tail or with his eyes, anyway, not with the end, okay? And my prediction is, again, that you will see shift of the activity from the end to the tail, okay? So verify this assumption that the behavioral manipulation, okay, that you get... dimensional reduction, which is appropriate to the behavioral task that you are engaged in, okay? So you are now trained for neural network, okay? But not for the basal ganglia. So for you, all the basal ganglia is one big cluster. If you will care about the basal ganglia, you will start to divide the basal ganglia into small cluster. This is the issue.
So the first step of the basal ganglia abolishes the correlation, then why do you need the four other stages?
So again, first of all, I'm careful, and I'm speaking about the striatum, GPE, GPI, okay? And the reason that I'm speaking about this is because the cortex on one side and the thalamus, which is reciprocally connected with the cortex, are already both on the input and the output side, okay? So it could be that they are already after the expansion. So I strongly believe that like in the retina that you have from 100 million to 1 million and then you have expansion, okay, probably this is the case also in the basal ganglia. So when we are going to the thalamus and back to the cortex, there is expansion. Actually, this is the dream. The dream now with Avital, poor Avital, is to test it from the striatum to the GPE to the GPI, okay? We are going to the. I don't know. Again, okay. It is. Again, and the question is how much it's flat, okay? So it could be.
Last question.
What you described, I mean, about the fact that every structure you find task related activity, it's true for the basal ganglia, but it's also probably true for the motor cortex and everything. But when you take away the motor cortex, the person is not blind, he cannot move. And when you damage the basal ganglia, the most obvious effect is a motor effect.
I will put it this way. First of all, I've done the distinction. I say that when I speak about the plastic brain and the plastic basal ganglia, I am putting aside the retina or the first stage. Okay, clearly, if we are going outside of the periphery, we are speaking about very specialized area of the brain. But as we go more inside to the brain, we see the more plastic and the more diverse related activity. Second, from my point of view, all our behavior is motor, okay? I don't believe that there is anything except of motor, okay? We are here, actually, we are trying to optimize our behavior in order to move as more gene to the next generation. To this, we have to find food, to avoid the danger, and to find sexual partner. This is all motor action, okay? And the fact that we speak from time to time and we believe that we have cognition, I think this is a redundant or epiphenomena.